30 years ago, a new youth culture erupted onto the streets of London. It was provocative, brash, and uniquely British. It was punk.
Punk was many different things to different people. I mean, for some it was just a chance to dress up. For some it was a chance to rebel. For some it was just something new and exciting. The idea was to shock a bit, I think. And whereas everything before had been wide lapels and very wide ties and flared trousers, and everything was wide and big, punk went to the other extreme and became very narrow and tight and a lot sexier, I think. I think it was a way of escaping from the mundanity of averageness. It was a great sort of liberation of the human spirit, where you could just put on what you wanted, it didn't matter. Obviously there were a few sort of intolerant people who gave you a bit of verbal abuse from time to time, but you just learned to ignore them. Just rather sad creatures who didn't have a life of their own.
This was Phil Munnock before he discovered punk and got himself a new look and a new name.
I was working as a copywriter in the ad industry, so we had to dress very properly during the day in a shirt and tie. I used to change in the toilets if I was going out in the evening into my punk gear. And then I came out and very zippy plastic gear with bondage straps and a little spiky dog collar, and people fell off their seats. They were quite shocked.
In his punk persona, Phil became Captain Zip. And for nearly 4 years, he spent his weekends filming the punks who gathered on London's King's Road.
Nobody was shooting a lot of film, especially not of the punks on the street. I was never asked to make a payment because they thought of me as I was one of them. But if a tourist came along and wanted to take a photograph of a punk, they'd be asked to pay. I remember in 1978 it started off 10p, and by 1981 it was £2 for a photograph, so there was enormous inflation.
Phil got to know some of the punks he filmed very well. Today, he's running the footage he shot for one of the young punkettes who appeared in a number of his films, who was known in the 70s as Anne Wobble.
We're back on the King's Road again.
Oh, there's me!
Yes.
And Mary.
Wow.
Mary's got my top on.
Anne was living at home in Harrow when she really got interested in punk culture.
Oh, something look young.
By the time she was 16, she had started experimenting with the punk look.
One day we were walking along in nice little floral skirts, and the next minute we were in ripped up clothes, safety pins, dog collars, and doing weird and wonderful things with our hair. Just really happened very quickly. My mum didn't mind. My mum even helped me bleach my hair and things, and helped me spike it up. My dad wasn't too pleased. He disowned me for about a year. But his thing came round. It was like a way of life. It was fashion, it was music, it was friends. If you were a punk, you were a punk. And you just all talk to each other. You'd just be out for having a laugh, and that was it.
You'd bump into someone you knew, and you'd jump up and down and say hello, and then you'd go off to the pub and have a few drinks. It was just sort of socialising, really.
One of the popular places in Chelsea for buying the torn T-shirts, animal prints and strappy bondage gear worn by many of the young punks was Beaufort Market. But in 1979, the shops and stalls faced closure. Beaufort was scheduled for redevelopment.
Oh, hanging about down the Market Street. I spent a lot of time on my feet when I saw some boss in your boat.
To go out with a bang, one of the stallholders booked the punk band The Clash to perform from the rooftops.
He made two mistakes about this. First, he didn't apply for a licence to do that. And secondly, he publicised it very widely in the music press. So the police noticed this was happening, or some authority noticed, and decided to close the market down the day before. So all these punks turned up from all over the place, enormous number of punks. And obviously, nothing was happening. There was nowhere to go. They were just hanging around. Nobody was making any announcements about what was happening. So the police turned up to sort of herd them away. I got told to stop filming and told to go away, and I went away and around the block and started filming it from another angle.
As the 80s arrived, punk departed, and Phil's films have become a rare record of a subculture that defined the late 70s. But for Anne, the films have a more personal significance.
I haven't seen the films for about 25 years or so, and it's absolutely brilliant to see them again. It really is brilliant. You know, it takes you back. It just seems like yesterday. If I could have my time round again, I'd do it all over again.
I think a lot of people do remember punk very fondly. And I'm sure there are other people who are pretty pleased to see the back of it. But I don't think punk will ever be forgotten. I don't think there's been anything before or since that's been so colourful and liberating.